Hi everyone, welcome to this session on Google Cloud Authentication. So today we are going to be covering the basics of how authentication works in Google Cloud. The session is primarily intended for beginners. So if you are new to Google Cloud, or maybe you have used a couple of services in Google Cloud but still not comfortable with the entire ecosystem, and you want to know more about how authentication works on Google Cloud, then this is the session for you. A recording of this session will be available later on YouTube, and we also have an article which has been published on Devopedia platform. So that can also be a useful reference for later reading. So I will share that link with you towards the end of the talk. So before I share my screen, a basic introduction of what is authentication. You might have also heard of the term authorization. So these two terms are very commonly used in the industry, and naturally these two terms are very intimately related. So when you are a beginner, it's good to know what is the difference between authentication and authorization. So in very simple terms, authentication is about confirming the identity of the user. So it's all about identity. Are you who you say you are? So that is what authentication is all about. Authorization, on the other hand, is about what you are allowed to do. Let's say you are already into the system, you are allowed only a certain level of privileges, or you can acquire only some roles. So those roles will limit what you can do with the resources that the system offers. So this is the basic difference between authentication and authorization, and it's helpful for everyone to know this and understand this difference. So let's try to understand this through a couple of simple examples, everyday examples. Take Google search. Is there any authentication? Absolutely not. There is no authentication whatsoever on Google search. Anybody can go to google.com and they can start searching for anything they want. So Google is not going to authenticate you for using that service. But again, coming to Google search, what about authorization? Is there any authorization in Google search? The answer is yes. You may not even realize it, but there is an implicit authorization in Google search. You are only limited to a certain number of searches per minute, per hour, per day, but Google doesn't explicitly publicize this. But there is an upper limit how much you can search on Google search. A good way to test this is you automate the search using an automation tool, let's say Selenium. And you try to bombard Google with a lot of queries. Try sending one query per second. Very soon you will hit the limit, and Google will block you for maybe 1 hour, 2 hours before they allow you to do any search from that particular IP address. So this implicit limit which Google puts on how many searches you can do, that is what we call as authorization. So it's a set of privileges what you can do with the system. So let's take another example, Google Drive. So in Google search, we saw that there is no authentication. What about Google Drive? I have a set of files which I have saved on Google Drive, and I want to access those files. And obviously, I don't want anybody else, like my friends or colleagues, to access those files. So definitely for Google Drive, there is an authentication that is involved. So typically this authentication assumes the pair. You enter a username and you give a password. And when these match, then you are authenticated and you are allowed access to Google Drive. So that is the typical authentication that happens in most systems. So that is authentication on Google Drive. What about authorization on Google Drive? So once I am authenticated and I enter Google Drive, I am authorized pretty much to do anything I want with that account. I can delete files, I can move files, I can rename files. So I have a lot of flexibility because those files belong to me. I am the owner of those files. I can share files with others. But what I am not authorized to do is that I can't access files of another user in the system. Although the files may be stored on the same physical device, but I can't access files of another user within the Google ecosystem. So that is the level of authorization I have on Google Drive. Another example of authorization is in my free account, I have 15 GB of storage space. So that is the storage that Google Drive gives. So that is the authorization that I get. But if I want more storage, then I have to get a paid account. I have to start pay some amount monthly to Google Drive, and that will give me 100 GB of space. So by making a payment, I am authorized now for higher storage capacity. So authorization works on different levels. You know, you can define roles and attach different levels of authorization to those roles. Typical roles are like guest, owner, manager, administrator, super administrator. These are the typical roles that we find in computer systems. And each role has a set of associated authorizations. So I just wanted to introduce this concept of both authentication and authorization before we get into the specifics of Google Cloud. Although today's talk is titled Google Cloud Authentication, you know, there are elements of authorization that we will be touching upon. With that introduction, I will now start sharing my screen. Can everyone see my screen? Ramanathan?
Yes, sir.
Yes, we can see the screen.
Yeah. So this is the article which has been published on Devopedia. I'm using this as a reference. Now you will see that there are actually three types of, I will enlarge this. There are three types of authentication that Google provides. So the three types are API key, OAuth client ID, and service account. So we will understand all these three, but before we get into this, let's just talk about the user. When I say user, I'm talking about the end user, like you and me. How do we get into Google? The typical way for a user to get into Google is to enter a username and password. That's the pretty much standard way to get into Google. But for enhanced security, there are other things which Google has added onto that basic username and password. So the common way is two-factor authentication, where, you know, if Google has your mobile number, it will send you an SMS. And using that, so an OTP will be sent to the SMS, or typically, OTP sent to the SMS. And you use that SMS OTP to do the second factor of authentication. Another way is these days, again, it's common if you are on Android or iOS, you might have installed an app, or, you know, if you are in Android, that is for the Google ecosystem, you know, a notification will come to the Android phone saying that, you know, you are trying to log into your account. So this is the second factor of authentication. So once you click that, then you get access to your account. So that is how users log into their account on Google ecosystem. But right now, today's discussion is not about how users are logging in. We are talking about how applications can gain access to resources managed by Google. And because we are developers, we are more interested in this aspect of the discussion, how applications can access services which are within the Google ecosystem. So there are three ways, as you can see on the screen: API key, OAuth client ID, and service account. So the first question that will come to your mind is, how, given these three things, how do I select the most suitable one for my application as a developer? So let's look at this particular image. So this is taken directly from Google documentation. So each one has a specific use case. So suppose you are accessing public data anonymously, then the best way to do this is through an API key. So here, this is actually taken from Google documentation, but I think we should be careful how to interpret this term, public data. When I say public data, it doesn't mean that the data belongs to the public. In fact, most of the data exposed by Google is owned by Google. So when Google says in this context public data, what it means is that the data is accessible to the public through a public API. So that is what we mean by this term public data. So don't misinterpret this term thinking that it's data owned by the public. So this is the first case. Then the second case is private data. So let's say I have a lot of files on Google Drive. That is data which is private to me. And if I want another application to access that data, then I should not choose API key. Rather, what I should be doing is to use the second type of authentication, which is OAuth 2.0 client. So we'll understand the details of this a little later. I'm just giving a high level view, where OAuth client can be useful. So now one of the things which happens in this OAuth 2.0 client authentication flow or authorization flow is that the user is presented a prompt. So the user has to say yes. And only after that authorization is done by the user, the flow can go to the next step. So what I'm trying to say is this particular OAuth 2.0 client involves some sort of a user interaction. But what if your application is running inside the Google Cloud? Let's say it's inside running inside a compute engine. It's running in cloud functions. So it's running inside a Google environment, Google Cloud environment, and there is no way for you to ask a user for authorization. So how is it possible for an application running inside Google Cloud to gain access to other services on Google? So this is where service account becomes useful, because you can't use OAuth 2.0 client because you don't have a user to give you authorization. So the process has to be somewhat automated. So that is where service account becomes useful. Another use case where service account is useful is, let's say your application is running outside the Google Cloud, but it wants to access services inside the Google Cloud. And again, this whole application is automated. So again, in this particular use case, a service account becomes useful. So these are the different use cases, and these use cases are mapped to the most suitable authentication that we can use as developers for these applications. Now, all this might seem a little abstract, so let's look at some examples, and I will also show you the code for each of these examples. And in fact, at Devopedia, we are using all three of these types of authentication, and of course suited to the application that we are using. So let's start with the API key and go a little bit more into the details of how to use API key. So the typical way in which you create an API key is to go to the Google Cloud console. You can see the URL here, console.cloud.google.com. And once you go here, you will be presented with a dashboard, and you go to credentials. And under credentials, you can see these three sections: API keys, OAuth 2.0 client IDs, and service accounts. So for our first use case, we are interested in the API key. So you can go here, start creating an API key, and then a new key is generated. And you close it, and you can see here a key is generated. And this is the actual key that you can copy and use it in your application. And when a key is created, there is a warning that appears. So what this means is, right now this key is pretty much unrestricted. Anybody who gets hold of this key can use it. But from a security standpoint, this is not really good. It's really good for you if you can restrict the usage of this key. So there are many ways in which you can restrict it: by IP address, by Android apps, by iOS apps, or HTTP referrer. So to give you an example, suppose this key is going to be used from the Devopedia server. Then I can specifically put a HTTP referrer restriction, and I can say the referrer is devopedia.org. So by doing this, what I am saying is this key can be used only by a HTTP call which comes from this server. Even when I do localhost testing, I will not be able to use this key. Google is going to reject that request. So this is, in general, putting restrictions to your API key is a good security practice. Because if somehow people get hold of the key, they should not misuse the key. So these kind of restrictions help you to limit how much damage can be done. So likewise, you can put a restriction by IP address, or maybe you want the key to be used only by an Android app that you have released on the Google Play Store or an iOS app. So you can put those restrictions. So the restriction so far that we have been talking about is restricting who is making the API call. But what about the destination? What is the, so this is about the source. What about the destination? What is the API key allowed to do? So here you can see no restrictions are placed on the API key, but here also you can put a restriction. So I can say, for example, Google has, you know, dozens of APIs. I can put a restriction to this. I can say that this key is limited only to Google Drive and cloud storage. No other service can be accessible through this key. So this kind of a restriction I can put. I hope this is clear. I will pause here for you to ask any questions or any clarifications. And once I save it, the warning that was previously here, the warning disappears. So now it says that API key has been restricted. So this is a good configuration. So let's look at a practical example how it is used. I'll take example of Devopedia itself. I'll go to a typical article on Devopedia. So I'm showing you a real world use case. This is how we use it in our application. So this is an article published on Devopedia on data science. And in this article, there is a YouTube video which is embedded in this article. So this is just one example. Like this, there are so many articles on Devopedia where YouTube videos are embedded as part of this article. But sometimes what happens, the creator of the video deletes that video. And when the video is deleted, here a funny message will appear, which doesn't look good on the article page on Devopedia. So what we have is periodically we make an API call to YouTube to check if the video is still available. And if the video for some reason has been deleted by the owner, then we give a notification to the authors of this article. So, you know, every article has one or more authors. So these authors will get notified that, you know, the video which is being embedded in this particular article has been deleted. So then the authors will come to this article and then they will take some sort of a corrective action. Maybe they will find an alternative video to suit this particular question, right? So this thing is not private data. Why did we choose API key for this kind of use case? Because this is not private data. Anybody can query the YouTube API and they can find out details about what that video is all about. So this is a perfect example where API key is suitable. And now I'll show you the code which actually does this. This is the Devopedia code. It's a PHP code. So where we are doing some crawling, and here we are calling the YouTube API. So this is the endpoint, and the actual endpoint that we are using could either be videos or playlists. It doesn't matter which we use. Both will give back equivalent results. And along with this request, notice here what we do. We are passing the key. This is the API key which was generated on the console. Remember, in our console here, we generated an API key, this one, which we can copy here. This API key is the one that is being used in the code here. And you will also notice, as a security practice, we are reading this API key from some other source. Maybe it's a JSON file or an environment variable. So the key is not hard coded in the code, because this code is going to be checked into the version control system in our Git repository. So we don't want to put secrets in our code. So again, a good security practice is never put your keys and other credentials in your code. Always use them via a JSON file, which is not version controlled, which is there only in your local environment, or read them from your environment variables. So that is another good practice for managing your keys or using your keys in production. So in this particular case, we make a curl request with the particular endpoint, passing the API key, and then we look at the response. If we get a null response, it may be because YouTube API failed to respond. But if we get a proper response, And if there are no items, it means the video has been deleted. So then the notification will go to the authors saying that video has been deleted. So this is an example where we are using API key as the first method of authentication. And why did we use this particular authentication method? Because the data is public. To complete this particular explanation, we will do something interesting. So Google has something called API Explorer. So whatever we saw in the code here, this can be tried out by any developer without before even writing the code. So how to do this? You go to Google Explorer. It's part of developers.google.com. And here we are looking in particular at the YouTube API. And in YouTube, we are looking at videos endpoint. And one of the command is list. So let's take the first one, list by video ID. And immediately you can try this API where you can say, I want a snippet of the video, content details and statistics. And then I give the video ID. So it so happens that I have a video here, which is our own video that is just hold on, a pop-up is disturbing me. Okay, pop-up has disappeared. Okay, so the this is a YouTube video which is published on Devopedia channel. So what I'm going to do is I have given these are the things I want about the video, and then I give the ID. Now, how do I do the authentication? There are two ways in which I can authenticate: Google OAuth 2.0 or API key. But remember, we are not doing anything related to user data. All we are doing is a public API call. So we don't really need Google OAuth 2.0. All we need is an API key, and we can execute this. So we get a expected response, no errors. It's a 200 status code. And then we get all the details about the video, when it was published, what is the channel ID, description, resolutions in which the video is available, and statistics, what is the view count, how many likes are there. We can also go and check whether it matches. So 3 likes, view is 41. And in the response, we got 42. That may be because we didn't refresh it. Somebody else might have accessed the video in between. So if we refresh it, so it's you can see here it's a 42 views and 3 likes. So the data here is consistent with what we got in the response. View count is 42, like count is 3. So this is how you query the YouTube API. And the only authentication we used is the API key, because we didn't need to use the Google OAuth 2.0. Any questions at this point? So next we will move on to Google OAuth 2.0. But before that, if you have any questions on API key, I'll take them now.
Yep. This is a publicly available information. And yep. What is the value add we get because we used API key?
Yeah, and the thing is, we don't, we can't query the YouTube API without the API key.
Okay, you get this JSON response because you are using API key. Otherwise, you only get to use the link.
You mean to say you want to do web scraping?
No, there has to be a value add because it's publicly available information. API key is generated for a purpose. What is the value add this API key is bringing?
Value add, you can see the value add from our use case itself. Why are we making this call? Because we want to find out the status of the video. And on whether the video is available or deleted, we will inform, notify the authors. So in our use case, you know, this is a perfect example where, you know, the API and the API key is useful.
Okay. And does this cost you anything because you are using this API key?
No, there is no cost. There may be certain, again, we come back to authorization. There may be certain limits, but very rarely you will hit those limits. So if you go to the dashboard, you will see here how much API traffic you are consuming. So you can see the traffic here, and you can also see some statistics, latency of the API calls, any errors your calls are throwing. And here you can see Google Drive, I have made 60 requests, zero errors and so on. So there is another use case where we are using the Google Drive API. So that is captured here. So now, there is obviously a limit, but for common use cases, you will not hit this limit.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. Any further questions? If not, we go to the second use case, which is about accessing private data on behalf of an end user. So we'll give a simple example. How are we using it in Devopedia? And the example is very simple. Take, for example, logging into Devopedia. How can people log into Devopedia? So if you don't have an account, you can create an account by clicking this link. But an easier flow for the user may be to connect one of their social accounts. It could be Facebook or Google or LinkedIn, GitHub or Bitbucket. So how is this implemented? So this is powered by the OAuth technology. So OAuth, in fact, OAuth is actually a method for authorization. It is not meant for authentication. It is only a method for authorization. But Google and many providers use OAuth 2.0 for both authentication and authorization. So that is why, it is covered under the authentication framework. So how does, a typical OAuth flow work? Just to give you a brief idea, if you are new to OAuth. So let's say in our example, Devopedia is the application, and it wants access to the user's information, which is held by Google. So let's say one of our visitors has an account with Google, and he is new to Devopedia. He wants to create an account. So he will connect with Google. So how does this flow actually work? So how it works is, first the application, which in OAuth terminology is called a client. So the application will make an authorization request to the user, and the user will grant the authorization. What the user is basically saying is, yes, I am authorizing you to read my information from Google. So that is the kind of authorization which the user is granting. So for this to happen, the user is actually prompted. So typically this flow will happen on the browser. So a pop-up will come for the user, and the user will say, okay. Once this authorization is obtained by the client will make an authorization request to the authorization server, which in our example is Google. So now Google will check the credentials. The main thing it will check is the client ID. So every application will have a client ID, and this client ID is pre-configured on Google. So I will show you that shortly. So this client ID will go to the authorization server as part of this grant. And so Google will verify that, and if it matches, it will give an access token to the application. So now this access token is very useful. This token is then used by the client to query the resource server. So typically the resource server can be same as the authorization server. They could be logically separate. That's how OAuth is defined it, but in real world implementations, they could be the same server. In fact, in our use case, both are Google, so they could be the same server. So ultimately, this access token comes to the Google server, and Google server releases the resources requested by the application. So in our case, what are the things that we request Google from Google? At the base thing, we request username, the name of the user, and the email address, plus the profile picture of the user. So these are the things we request, and we save those things and create an account on Devopedia. So that is how we are using OAuth 2.0 client ID within the for our Devopedia, for onboarding users into the Devopedia system. So let's look at an example here of creating such a. So creating the OAuth client ID is very simple. You go here, OAuth client ID, application type, Android, web app, web application, desktop application. So in the case of Devopedia, it's a web application. So you give a suitable name and then you create it. Authorized JavaScript origins, authorized redirect. So some more configuration you have to do. So what authorized redirect URIs mean is after the resource is granted, suppose after this is done, where should the user be redirected to? So that means after the user is onboarded to Devopedia platform, he will be redirected to a certain page. So typically we may take the user to, you know, user dashboard, or typically we will take the user to this page, you know, author guidelines, because the user has just signed up as a new author. So we may take the user to this particular page. So that is the reason for this authorized redirect URLs. So this is where, you know, the user will be redirected to. And authorized JavaScript origins, again, it's good to configure. I mean, I think it's essential to configure these things so that there is a greater security for your application and for your users. So let's do a trial of this in our API Explorer, which is given by Google. Now let's come back to our original question. Why do we need to use OAuth 2.0 client ID? Because we are trying to access something private. So that is the use case where this method fits the bill. So let's stick to the same endpoint videos. And here there is a interesting command, list my liked videos. Obviously this is kind of private data, because let's say, you know, I cannot go and find out what are the videos which have been liked by Ramanathan, for example, because that is Ramanathan's private data. That data is owned by Ramanathan. But I can very well find out what are the videos which are liked by me. But still it is private data. It is private to me. So the Explorer will not be able to access this. So Explorer, in our example, Explorer is the application. Explorer is the client. So Explorer, to access this particular information, it has to get authorization from the user. In this example, I am the user. I am the end user. So let's see how this works. We will stick to the same video like before. So this is the video ID, and the video ID is already here. And so I am saying my rating, like, so this was not configured earlier. By clicking this, I have configured this. And what about the ID? Oh, ID is not required in this case, because I want a list of all videos that I have liked and information about those videos. Okay. So now API key is not going to be useful, but let's give it a try. We'll not do any Google OAuth 2.0. We'll use only the API key and execute this. Immediately we get an error. Request is missing required authentication credentials. So now Google recognizes that you are trying to use an API key, but this particular use case API key is not enough. You need something like this. That is why your request has been denied. So it is unauthorized, unauthenticated. So your API request has failed. So what you need is actually Google OAuth 2.0. And now we'll make our request and see what happens. Execute. Now this is the pop-up that comes up. Now as a user, I am user, my username is Devopedia Foundation. As a user, I am giving now API Explorer authorization to access my information from YouTube. So I am authorizing, and this screen is presented, your YouTube account, and I say allow. Now once I have granted this, the Explorer immediately queries the YouTube API with the OAuth credentials, and then I get the expected output. Okay. So why did, so again, to conclude, you know, this particular method of authentication, why did we choose OAuth in this case? Because we are trying to access some sort of a private data, which you cannot access through a API key. You have to use a better method of authentication, which is Google OAuth 2.0.
So Arvind, where did you configure OAuth is required?
Only here. I just clicked this, nothing more than this.
Client part. In the server part?
Yeah, so I will show you the code. Because we are inside the Google Explorer, we don't have to do anything. This is only an experimental platform. That means developers can use this to experiment with the APIs before they actually write the code. So, but typically I have, let's say through my console, I have created the OAuth client ID. Let's say I created. And then I get two things. I get the client ID and I get the client secret. So now your question is, where am I using these things? These things I will use when I write my application code. So this is my application code. Again, it is PHP code. And you see what is happening. I am calling Google accounts. And URI, not yet, okay. So this is the URL, Google accounts. Yeah, some of the code is abstracted in another module. And there is something called scope, which I will explain shortly. And there is a redirect URL and so on. But the point to address Raja's question is right here. So from my Google console, cloud console, I got the two things, client ID and client secret, which I included here in my HTTP request. And then I make the API call. Then in the response, I will get the token. See, this is only the first part of the flow. Remember, the OAuth flow has two parts. One is, you know, making the authorization request grant. Then when you get the token, use the token to get the protected resource. So we have done the first part where we got the token. Then in the next request, we will use the token to obtain the user information. So that is what is happening in this bit of code. So we got the, we did the request, we got the response, and from the response, we get the token. Using the token, we make another URL request. And from that response, we will extract the rest of the things.
Sure, thank you.
So Google Cloud provides this OAuth only for the Google accounts or for GitHub and every other account?
No, no, each one will have their own flows. Suppose
OAuth, okay.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, our use case is Devopedia. You can see here. Suppose I don't want to use Google. I want to use Facebook to do connect Facebook with the Devopedia account. Then, you know, my resource owner server and authorization server is Facebook. So all these requests will go to Facebook.com.
Okay.
Google is not involved. So so these things must be implemented by the platforms that have these identities.
Okay. And how about state management? That you are handling it, right? From the app side, we have to handle it.
What do you mean state management?
Whether the user logged in or did he log out?
That is all part of the app. That is after the flow is over, everything else that happens is within the app.
Okay.
Yeah, now the user is not logged in. If I click this, the user will get logged in. But when the login happens, let's say all, you know, we have already gone through all this. Grant is already made, granted. So, and the account way, the account is already created on Devopedia. So it will simply log in the user straight away.
Yes.
How long this access token is valid?
Yeah, so that is a good question. Typically, applications should not keep using the same access token. So the for reasons of security, access tokens should be short-lived. So periodically, they have to exchange the access token with the authorization server. So that, you know, good developers will implement this in the code.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, one important question which no one has asked, and yeah, that is very important to complete the understanding of OAuth, is when application makes authorization request to the authorization server, not request, authorization grant to the server, and this access token is released, the question will arise, what kind of data is now the application authorized to access? Because potentially the user has lots of data on Google. I have my private files, I have my Google calendar, I have lots of files on Google Drive, I have my Gmail, all the mails are in Gmail, right? But there is only one account, it's a single sign-on system. So when I authorize the app, what kind of permissions is the I'm granting to this app? So that is determined by what is known as scope, which I mentioned earlier, I'll come back to it. So you can see here, there is something called scope. So it is important for the, so this is done by the application. So for example, let's go back to the flow. When this grant goes to the authorization server, this grant should include the scope. What sort of permissions am I requesting? And you can also see this in the pop-up that is presented to the user. So the user is shown what kind of permissions that the application is requesting. You know, typically you would have seen this when you are installing iOS or Android apps. The same thing happens in the OAuth flow. So that is determined by this scope setting. And the scope is, in this particular case, the only things we are asking from Google is, give me the user profile, give me the user's email address. This is all we are asking. We are not asking access to Google Drive or calendar or Google Photos or any of those things. We are asking only for these two things. If we ask for something special, access to Google Drive and all that, it will be very restrictive API, and it may have to go through an approval process from Google. That means Google will audit your application to check whether your application deserves those permissions. But this is a very basic level of scoping, which no audit is required. So immediately your application is authorized to get this information. So you may ask, you know, how do I find out where these kind of scopes are listed? So there is one page on Google documentation which lists the OAuth 2.0 scopes for all the Google APIs. It's a very handy page. You know, there are dozens of APIs managed by Google. You can see the list here. It runs to more than 230 to be precise. And for all those APIs, the scopes are listed. So as a developer, this is a very indispensable, you know, page, reference page, I would say. So whenever I am, you know, integrating applications to the Google API, I refer to this. What each scope means, and you know what, how to use these scopes. The other very useful resource for developers is, of course, the Google API Explorer. So the good practice for developers is to test out and understand the API through this interface before actually writing the code. That is what I do. Any questions before we move on to the third authentication method, which is the service account?
Sir, in the OAuth client 2.0, as you said, the access tokens have been granted by the authorization server. The authorization server and the DevOpedia server, they need to have some delegation, right? So basically, when we are generating the access token, authorization server should know that to which services it is providing the access. Like, there has to be some developer token or some delegate token which is with which this authorization server is generating the access token, right? Is there anything in the GCP?
Yeah, see, what you say is token, if I understand correctly, it is not, it is this access token. So this access token is not pre-configured. What is configured is the client ID and the client secret. So the client ID and client secret is to authenticate the application, identify the application. But the actual access of the resources happens through this short-lived tokens. So if anybody gets hold of these tokens, it doesn't matter, because in the next time around, the application may do this process again, and it will get new tokens, and only those tokens will be valid.
Understood. But if we see this authorization server and the reference server, let's say this reference server is a Devopedia server and authorization server is a
Google. That is not possible. Both of these are controlled by the same organization.
Okay, then there is no need of delegation. Yeah.
See, I, it's possible that there is some communication happening here between authorization server and resource server, but that is internal to Google. Because I understand your point, because token is coming from here, how will this guy recognize the token?
Right.
I understand now what is your question. So that is because there is internally some communication is happening between authorization server and resource server, which is not shown in this diagram.
Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, but typically, you know, both these servers may be physically the same server in Google.
Yeah.
But because if they happen to be different servers, there is a protocol that is going on between these two.
Yeah. Understood. Because I have seen this the same O2.0 implemented in signing with Apple that is corresponding to iOS. There, what happens is instead of having these access tokens, they give you refresh tokens. Using the refresh tokens, you get the access tokens. So I
thought that is one more level of indirection. Yeah, so that is fine. Yeah.
So I asked you like if there is anything which is in this too. Well, thanks for answering that question. Yeah.
Any further questions before we move on to the next one?
One thing, Arvind, I had doubt.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
What is the validity for each authorization request?
For each authorization request, you mean this one?
Yeah.
So that actually the I'm not sure about that. See, what happens is I will describe my experience. Once I have authorized Devopedia to access my account in Google, that is stored in the database within Devopedia. So the next time I log into Devopedia, again the user is not prompted, because it is already stored here. So I understand your question. So I will answer this question by going here.
No, so, because in the last statement you mentioned that both for every authorization request, a new access token will be created, right?
That is over here. Yeah, so that is here. From Correct. In these two flows, this will happen probably every time, but this one happens only once.
Okay.
So for this, I will show you show you the example. So anyone can go to this particular page, myaccount.google.com, and it will give you these kind of high level information, home, personal info, etc. Go to security. And here you will see all the apps which are being given access to your account, third party apps. So now you can see here, I have given access to Google APIs Explorer.
Sorry.
So this access or authorization that I have given to this Google APIs Explorer is indefinite. There is no expiry time attached to this. But I can click this and remove the access. So if I remove the access, you see what happens. Once I remove the access, now I cannot make the same call. If I make the same call, again, I will be prompted. In this case, what happened? It says immediately invalid. So invalid. So I'm not getting the pop-up. So what I do a trick. I select a different scope. Now Google will be forced, API Explorer is forced to ask for user authorization. Again, I authorize, I allow. So this is where you see the scope is coming up, and I allow. And once I allow, I get the response. And if I go back to my account, I will see that again I have given authorization to Google APIs Explorer. See, again it has come back. I clicked this just a minute ago. Again, I have authorized this app to access my account. So this flow is only once.
I understood. That is the first flow. Authorization request happens for the first
time. But this one happens repeatedly when you want to access exchange tokens. Because your access tokens are short-lived. You don't want to keep reusing those tokens.
Exactly. So what is the validity of those access tokens? Is it something that if a same user, like, you know, asking for authorization grant, like for example, first step is happened and I'm the one who wants to have a authorization grant and a first time access token got generated. And again, what is the validity of that access token? Can I go back, make use of the same access token for the next time when I want to access that particular application? Or how is
it? There is a wide variety of access tokens. Some are short-lived, some are indefinite, meaning that they will never expire. And some platforms like Facebook, they are more strict. They will ask you to renew it every 24 hours. So there is a big variety there. Let me see in our code how it is done, whether we exchange it or not. Actually, this is partly we are using a third party plugin here. So here it is not clear whether it is exchanged. But presumably this you can exchange it every time if you want. So that means what I mean to say is that to answer your question more directly, I have already authorized, I've gone through the step, I logged out of Devopedia. The next time I log in, again a new access token will be generated. So I believe that this code is written like that. So every time the user logs in, access token is generated. But if the user doesn't log out, the same access token will be preserved. Any further questions? So we are running out of time. So I'll move on to the next one, and then we'll see if there is time, we can take on more questions. So the last use case is service account, where I think many people maybe are not aware of service accounts or have not used them, but their use case is very specific and they are actually very important for applications running in the cloud. And even those applications which are running outside the cloud. So the use case in which Devopedia is using it is like this. So the data on Devopedia is never static. Every day people are coming, they are liking articles, they are writing comments, or they edit existing articles, new users join the system. So the data in the database is always changing. Now, although on the Devopedia server, daily backups are taken, both of the database as well as the code base, as well as the file system, backups are taken. We don't want to rely too much on those kind of backups. So what we decided was that we will have a separate backup in a different server physically, maybe even a different cloud system. So the decision was taken that every night we will take a backup of the relevant stuff on Devopedia, zip it, and upload all that stuff to Google Drive. And this whole process must be automated. There is no business of a user authorizing anything and stuff like that. So how do we make this happen without any kind of user interaction, even for the first time? That means even this kind of interaction is not allowed because there is no browser that is facing the user. The whole flow is going to happen on the Devopedia server, on the command line. So how do we make this happen? So this is where service account comes into play. So what happens is you create a separate account on Google, which is called a service account. And this service account is just like your user account, you know, that you and I use. But what is special about the service account is it doesn't have a UI. Like, you can't have a UI like this where you enter username and password. A service account cannot be used like that. The service account can be used only through automated tools and utilities, but that is perfect for our use case. So to give you an example here, let's come out of this. Let's create a service account. So you give some name, someone, and then a service account is associated with an email address like this. So the name of the account and then a big email address, some description, blah, 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 you put for now. Create and continue. Grant the service account access to the project. Grant users access to the project. And you can select some rules. You know, you can give, default rules which are available. Or typically you will restrict the role to. And for each of the service, there are different roles, right? So you can do this. The most browser editor owner. So this is like full access to all the resources. So typically you don't want to give this kind of access to your service account. You should restrict it to the minimum requirement that is needed by the application. So anyway, this is how you create your service account. Let's say done. Done, okay. So I have created my service account and what do I do now? So I have got a bunch of keys, metrics, logs, and so on. Permissions, grant access. So I'll show you how we are using it in the code. So the use case, just to repeat, what is the use case? The use case is every night we want to take a backup of Devopedia system and upload it to the Google Drive. So this is Python code here. And the beauty of this, all this code is that, you know, Google provides a lot of client-side libraries. So the service account is also built on top of OAuth 2.0, but that OAuth flow now is very transparent to the developer. It happens through the Google client libraries. And you may be wondering what are the underlying technologies used by the service account. So when this particular application is getting in touch with Google Drive, so it is one service talking to another service. So when they talk to each other, they exchange. This guy will present something called a JSON web token. But the JSON web token is itself may not be very secure. So what he does is this application signs the token with a private key. So the other technology which is necessary here is a RSA public private key. So a JSON web token is signed by a RSA private key, and that is exchanged with that signed token is exchanged with the Google Drive API. So Google Drive has the public key and it will do the verification. And after the verification is done, authentication is done, it will give access and you can do all these things. So what we are doing in this application, we are uploading the files. And we also have methods to delete the file, list the files, and so on. And then update the permissions. Now, question for you guys, some of you may or may not know. Okay, I have taken my backup, I have uploaded the backup to Google Drive. How do I see that backup? I cannot actually go to my Google Drive here. I have a Google Drive here. I cannot go to my Google Drive and see those files because this Google Drive is not the drive of the service account. Service account is like a user account, almost like a user account, just that it doesn't have a login. So you cannot actually log in through a web browser for a service account. And you cannot also use the API Explorer for the service account. API Explorer can be used only for these two things. Google OAuth and for API key. So you can't use because it's not it's supposed to be an automation environment, very much a developer environment. This facility is not there. So the interesting question is, how do you access the files in the Google Drive of the service account? That can be done only through your automation. So here I can do a listing of all the files. I can download the files and so on. But there is a trick. The trick is very simple, which all of us probably know in our everyday use. The trick is, although the files are in my service account, I simply share the file with my usual account, user account. So when I share it like this, it appears here. So this is one of the daily backups, as you can see here. So this file is actually residing in the Google Drive of the service account, but then I have shared it with my normal account. So it appears in my Google Drive. And the beauty of service account is, you know, all our user accounts have only 15 GB of space, but the service account has its own separate storage, another 15 GB. So when you share the files from your service account to your normal accounts, you are not actually consuming storage from your normal account. So this is the use case in which you can use service account. There are many other use cases. Let's say you are running an application in Google Cloud. Let's say it's running inside a Google Kubernetes cluster. Now your application probably wants to query a machine learning API. So the machine learning API is going to authenticate your application. How are you going to do that? So that is where, again, a service account is important. You require a service account and use the service account to authenticate your application, and then your application will be granted access to the machine learning API. So this is the end of my talk. I hope you found it useful. Any questions on service accounts? So just to conclude, we looked at three use cases. The first use case was YouTube use case, where from Devopedia system, we query YouTube to figure out whether the video is still there or it has been deleted. So there, all we need is a API key because it's basically public data. The second use case was somebody getting onboarded into Devopedia. So instead of asking the user to create an account on Devopedia, we say, why don't you connect your Google account and we will pick up your credentials, your username, your email address and your profile picture from Google. So there the user is authorizing Devopedia to pick up those credentials from Google, those information from Google. So there OAuth 2.0 client ID is used. So don't be confused by the term client ID. When we say client, what we mean is the application. In our example, Devopedia is the client, and client ID is the ID given to Devopedia application. So that was the second use case. The final use case was taking an automated daily backup of Devopedia and uploading those backup files to Google Drive. So here, because the whole process is automated, we use a service account. Any questions?
Arvind, I had a question in regards to OAuth 2.0. I had read somewhere about OpenID, I think. So, like, as you have told, like, OAuth 2.0 is basically used for the authorization part. But since some providers like Google and all, they are using it for the authentication as well. But I think something is built on top of that as well, like OpenID. I'm not sure much about it, but maybe.
Yeah, OpenID is basically sort of a specification. So what it means is that whether people implement it conforming to the specification. So if you look at Google documents, they will say our OAuth implementation is conformant to OpenID specifications. So it's more like a specification than anything else. And what it means to conform, what it means is it will become interoperable. Let's say I design my application for OAuth flow and try to use that flow with Google. I will be confident that it will work. My implementation will work against Google because OAuth says it is compliant with the OpenID specification. So that is the kind of confidence developers get. Mainly, it's about interoperability.
Okay.
So of course, if you want to know more information, we have this article on OAuth. So you can read up, the basics of OAuth from this article. The other article, which is more relevant to today's talk, is Google Cloud Authentication, which I wrote specifically for today's talk, and it was published yesterday. So this gives an overview of all the three methods that we have discussed today, and it gives a little bit more information, what are the do's and don'ts that you have to follow when using these three methods, and it gives some history how this has evolved. So those interested can look up this particular page. So that's it. Thanks for joining the call. The recording of this session will be available on YouTube shortly, and I hope you found the session useful.